What in the world are you doing?
Oh, I'm just pretending I'm inside a cell, and I just transcribed a gene, and so I've got the RNA, and now I'm cutting and pasting all the exons together.
But how do you know where to cut?
Oh, well, that's easy, because the exons and introns are colored here. The exons are in purple, and the introns are in orange, and I'm essentially taking and cutting out the introns and keeping the exons.
So we keep the exons, but we get rid of the introns?
Exactly. I know it sounds kind of counterintuitive, but we keep the exons and we cut out the introns.
So that's why the mRNA is shorter than the gene, because we're actually getting rid of some of the gene sequence. Except for the ones that only have one exon, right?
That's exactly right. Now, most genes have more than one exon. There are a few that have only one. But those genes that have more than one exon have to cut out all those introns in a process called splicing. That's what splicing is we cut out, splice out the introns, and we splice together all the exons.
Can we infer anything about the number of introns and exons based on the length of the mRNA?
So I want you to tell me, here are two mRNAs made from their respective genes. Here's a DNA gene and the mRNA copy that resulted, another DNA gene and its mRNA copy that resulted after transcription. I want you to tell me for both examples, how many exons do you think are in each gene? So here are the genes on the left and right, and beneath them are the mRNA copies. And just to be clear, on the left, the mRNA copy is the exact length as the DNA gene. And over here on the right, the mRNA copy is shorter than the DNA gene. So using the options below for each scenario, I want you to pick the best answer for the question, how many exons do you think are in each gene? This is a tough one, so think about it first and try again if you don't get it the first go round.